Dr. Michael Lobog, good afternoon and welcome.
Thank you. Welcome. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
So, I mean, I've known your work since 99, I think, when I read your book on the Mangaloreans. And I also got to know that you are a doctorate in maths.
That's right.
How did the two mix?
Well, mathematics was my initial interest, if I put it that way. I always thought when I was young that I could perhaps try and work on some famous unsolved problem in mathematics, which is why I went into the field. But it didn't quite work out that way. I mean, although I eventually obtained a doctorate and I was able to publish some papers in international journals and made a reasonable name, I could never reach the heights to which I aspired to be able to do something completely unique. And then one day, for personal reasons, I had to return home to Mangalore. I slowly got absorbed in this work in genealogy. One day I went, visited the church. I was fascinated with some very old records at Pelagris Church. They were written in calligraphic handwriting in an old register.
In Portuguese?
Very much in Portuguese. And I found the register of my great-great-grandfather and Pedro Antonio Lobo, written in briefly in Portuguese. At one time, I could have recited it by heart, but it was so many years ago that I don't trust myself to say it offhand just at this moment. But I was so fascinated with it. That set up the spark, as it were.
This was in which year?
In the 1993.
Okay.
I think it was 92. That was the year I first came. My mother was unwell. She was diagnosed with cancer. I wanted to spend some time with her. And that's when I went to this church and then I found this record. And this work took off from there. Slowly, people saw me researching church records and they wanted me to help them with their families. And in 2 years, this encyclopedia had grown to a point where it was something quite unique among all communities in the world.
You're talking about?
The genealogical encyclopedia of the Mangalorean Catholic family.
I see.
Was my first really venture into research.
It's a published book?
It's a published book. It's not exactly published.
Not
it's
printed.
Now, it's now about 10,000 pages.
Oh, wow.
I've published various offshoots of it. The book called Distinguished Mangalorean Catholics and then the one called The Professional History Directory are offshoots of that work. Each of these are also quite large in their own right.
Wow.
But the major encyclopedia is about 10,000 pages now. And it's a complete encyclopedia of genealogy of the Mangalorean Catholic community, whereby any member living today can trace his ancestry on his father's side, on his mother's side, on his paternal grandmother, paternal grandmother, and so forth. And there are cross-references by which one can switch from one line to another. And the work is now too large to bring out in book form, so I've got to see how best to make it available, either on the internet or maybe on CD form. Otherwise,
how many people does it cover?
About the total population of the Mangalorean community worldwide is roughly about 1 million.
So big.
Yes, but this main, obviously it doesn't cover all the families in the villages. I started with the better known families in Mangalore proper and it expanded from there. There are about 10,000 pages and there are maybe about 30 names in a page. So about, it may come to about 300,000, 3 lakhs.
Wow.
300,000. But then, that's historical, so I'm going back about 200 years.
I see.
That's about maybe one-fifth of the population as a whole.
Wow.
It's quite a large number. All the families that have done achieved something would be there, families of Mangalorean origin.
And then you went to your second book on the history of Mangalore?
No. This is other books on Mangalore were already offshoots of this encyclopedia.
Okay.
I have had other interests also, historically based. When I was in UK in the late 80s and early 90s, I did a book on the history of English words of Greek origin. That also was never finished. It was historical work. And I researched another on the history of popular Western songs, tracing from their origin, the names of the composers, the names of the singers who made them famous.
Which is this
book, which I brought here to show you.
So
that is this one, which is about 1,200 pages.
Oh, wow.
Which is this one I brought out recently. I had done most of the research when I was in England in the early 90s, but when I came back to India, there was no source of information, no avenue of research, so I put a stop to it while I was working on genealogy. Then with the advent of the internet, I was able to find other sources, I was able to fill in a number of gaps, and so finally I brought this book out, There are two books. So one is this one, which is like an encyclopedia,
yeah,
in which each page gives a song title and like that
just can we focus?
Okay, let's take one particular. Let's take Silent Night, which is well known.
Yeah,
I've covered. There are about two full pages on its history.
I see.
The history of the song, the original German words.
I see.
The English translation, the history itself is very interesting.
Yeah.
Shows when it was first composed in Germany in 1818, how it spread to Austria, how the king and queen of Saxony became fascinated with it when it was sung to the royal children, how in the Western countries it was first, they believed that it was not really church music, that it was only for the common people. But by the time the 20th century came into being, and suddenly with singers like Bing Crosby and others, they made it famous around the world, and now it's undoubtedly the best known of all the Christmas carols. So that kind of thing is covered. Of all popular songs, is covered in this book.
Yeah.
And it's companion work, which is a history which goes chapter by chapter.
Yeah.
And covers popular music of different eras, starting from the 19th century and coming on to the parlor songs of the early 20th century.
Any chance of doing something like this for Konkani music?
Konkani music, I don't have the requisite skills, okay. But there are others like Eric Osario, etc., who have done quite a lot of research. And there's a lady named Maria Lena Fernandez in Switzerland, who's trying to do some kind of research in Konkani and Goan music.
Really?
And the similarities, therefore. She was trying to be in touch. She was in touch with me, but whatever way I could help her, I did. But I don't really have sufficient expertise in that line.
Your interests are really vast and diverse.
Yes, thank you. So now life goes on. I've still covered my main work, which is the genealogy.
Yeah.
But I'm trying to promote this.
No, this book in the middle that came out during the anniversary of the captivity, of the end of the captivity.
Yes, that was in 1999.
Can you tell us?
The captivity was something quite unique in Mangalorean history because...
Very traumatic also.
Very traumatic. Because the Mangalorean community, which is also of Goan origin, our ancestors came from Goa and earlier from the Saraswati River Valley in North India at some indefinite period in the past. But from Goa, they started migrating to Mangalore in the late 16th century and early 17th century because they found life here rather tough. They were expected to follow certain norms which they had to give up certain ancestral customs which they didn't
economic
want.
Economic pressures also and
various
war
family.
Religious,
but
economic,
but
and war.
Mainly yes, they converted to Catholicism, but they didn't want to give up all their ways, which they would have been forced to if they remained in Goa. So they moved south and they were welcomed by the local rulers.
Yeah.
And they started their community. And it was by the end of the 18th century, it was quite a well-knit community. And that was the time that Tipu Sultan invaded Mangalore. And he was not in favor of Catholicism, Christianity by and large. And he thought it would be a security risk, which was one of the reasons why he took them all captive, kept them captive for 15 years. It was a very, like a black spot in the history of Mangalore.
Also disrupted the community life in that
entirely.
Sense.
And of the 60,000 who were taken captive,
yeah,
only about 15,000 returned to Mangalore. And that was in the year 1799. But from that point onwards, the community has developed.
Grown vastly,
From that point.
Done well for itself.
Yes, and we can trace our ancestry back about 200 years to the point. Many of the well-known families can trace their ancestry to the point at which an ancestor returned from the captivity.
Okay, but not beyond that.
But beyond that is quite difficult. There are no records.
I see.
Some of the best-known families have kept personal notes, but they can't be authenticated from church records. But from 1800 onwards, it's quite systematic. And so all the families of Mangalore proper can be traced more or less back to that date.
Doctor, DNA testing is offering new possibilities, no? Because there was a guy who wrote a book called The Last Prabhu.
Yes.
And he tested his DNA and put it online, and his closest match was someone who was a Mangalorean.
Yes.
36 generation down the line, who believed he came from the same village as him.
That's, of course, that's not my line again.
Okay.
But all you can say from DNA testing is that you're probably related to so-and-so to a certain degree. Now, it's possible that you and I may be very distant relations, since my ancestors came from Goa and the...
Which village?
1600. No, you and I.
Yeah, but which
we
village your ancestor?
I know, and I'm not quite sure which village they came from.
Many from Bardez.
Yes, mainly from Bardez in the north, and I think Salset. The south, from those two areas. But so with
it's
the help
possible.
Of DNA testing, Mangaloreans and Goans may find some distant relationship.
So these guys actually found that 36 generations down the line, they shared common ancestors, you know. And they, this guy from Mangalore believed that he came from this particular village in Aldona. So here's where science ties up with your oral history.
Yes. But that's the best you can get. I mean, you won't...
Yeah, of course.
The DNA won't tell you the names of your ancestors, the exact relationship. At best, it can tell you that there is some relationship.
Yeah.
If you accept the DNA study is accurate.
Yeah.
So that's it's fascinating, but...
So from here, where? What are your next goals?
Now, I've got to complete this genealogy first. It may take a year or two more. There are churches I've yet to research. I've got to go there.
Yeah.
And then, otherwise, I have many other writing projects in mind apart from music.
And in terms of your books published so far?
They are not selling very well.
No. I mean, that's a problem all of us small self-publishers face. But can you just tell us what are the books you've written? What are the books?
Some of the pictures are entered here.
There are quite a few.
This is Mangaloreans Worldwide, Distinguished Mangalorean Catholics, The Mangalorean Catholic Community, A Professional History and Directory.
Yeah.
Then these are some books which I have published but not authored, like Alan Machado's Saraswati's Children.
Yeah.
These are three books of essays by a gentleman named Lindsay Rago.
Yeah.
Nature's Beauty and Bounty, Silver Themes and Golden Thoughts.
I see.
From the Sublime to the Divine.
I see.
And these are my two books on popular music.
I see.
The 1,000 Pages of Song.
True.
And this very book, Popular Music, Historical and Thematic Analysis. So these 10 books.
That's
have
quite
been published
amazing,
in
work, amazing work. Amazing work. We really appreciate it and wish you all the best.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
And thank you for this.